heart, and I'm both excited and nervous about preaching it today. It's unlike anything I've ever preached before, but the title of it, I've just simply titled Sin Versus Grace, and what a fitting song for this message this morning as we talk about grace and the mighty battle, the world heavyweight championship of the world today in this message. And we're going to be reading from Romans chapter 5. And you can remain seated today. I'm going to read verses 12 through 21. You look and read along with me. Page 671 in the church Bible. Romans chapter 5, starting with verse 12. And here the Bible says, "Wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin, and so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. For until the law, sin was in the world, but sin is not imputed when there is no law. Nevertheless, death reigned from Adam to Moses, even over them that had not sinned after the similitude of Adam's transgression, who is the figure of him that was to come. But not as the offense, so also is the free gift. For if through the offense of one many be dead, much more the grace of God and the gift by grace, which is by one man, Jesus Christ, has abounded unto many. And not as it was by one that sinned, so is the gift. For the judgment was by one to condemnation, but the free gift is of many offenses unto justification. For if by one man's offense death reigned by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and of the gift of righteousness shall reign in the life by one, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as by the offense of one judgment came upon all men to condemnation, even so by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners, so by the obedience of one shall many be made righteous. Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound, but where sin abounded, grace did much more abound, that as sin has reigned unto death, even so might grace reign through righteousness unto eternal life by Jesus Christ our Lord." Father, thank you for the reading of your word this morning. Lord, help me to be able to stand boldly today. God, preach through me, please. God, help me today. It's these things I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, as I was preparing this message that God had laid on my heart, and as I told you, I'm both nervous and excited about it. It's overwhelming to me sometimes what God can place upon your thoughts and upon your heart as you read His Word. And I was reminded as I was reading this message or reading the Scripture today of a mighty battle that took place. And you may not see it in the Scripture as that way, but I saw it that way. I saw a mighty battle being fought between two opponents. I saw the battle between sin, and I saw the battle between sin and grace is what I saw. And I was reminded as growing up as a young man, I used to love to watch things like boxing and wrestling. I remember those great heroes of mine, these big muscle-bound modern-day gladiators, as they'd take to the ring. They'd announce their names in the ringside, and you'd hear the audience erupt with screams and yells, and you'd see both opponents standing across from each other, and you knew it was going to be a great fight, especially if you saw someone like Muhammad Ali. Back in the 70s when I was a little boy, he was one of my heroes. As I saw Muhammad Ali, as he would dance around the ring and do all the fancy footworks and say all the little rhymes, he was very sure of himself. If you ever saw an interview of him, you know how he was. He liked to brag and boast, but he would get in the ring and intimidate his opponent. He would say things like, "Float like a butterfly, sting like a bee, I'm the greatest, Muhammad Ali." And he would stand in that ring defying his opponent face to face, and they would cower in his presence. And I remember the man that took over his place. He was actually lived in Knoxville, Tennessee. Muhammad Ali retired there in about 1979.
and he gave up his world heavyweight championship. But this man that was he was born in Arkansas, but lived in Knoxville, Tennessee. He was one of the biggest men you've ever seen in your life. His name was Big John Tate. The man was a huge giant of a man. I got to meet him one time. I was a young man. It was back in 1978. This is before he won the world heavyweight championship, but he had won many battles by that time. The man fought 37 professional rounds and knocked out 23 men. He was a giant of a man. They cowered in his presence. He could punch you and knock you out cold in the middle of the ring because he was an intimidating figure in the ring. I remember seeing other battles as I would watch wrestling. I'd see all my heroes as Les Thatcher and Phil Rainey would announce them on the ringside. And they would announce such men as The Bullet, Bob Armstrong. I remember other men, Mitsu Kaniani. I remember Andre the Giant. I remember all these men that would stand and battle their opponents. And I'm not preaching about them this morning. I'm preaching about the battle between sin and the battle between grace. As I see these two giant opponents face each other off in the ring, in the center of the ring of the world of men's hearts and men's souls as they fight for them. I see as we approach the battle this morning, our text takes us back here to a no-holds-barred event. It takes us back all the way to the Garden of Eden, back when that first Adam appeared, that first man. And we all know the story. Adam, he partook of the fruit. And because of his sin, because he fell from grace on that day, because he fell in that garden and partook of that fruit that he was forbidden to partake of, his sin was imputed into all of man after that. We all inherited the sin nature of Adam as he fell in the Garden of Eden. And our Bible tells us that as we read from this morning. And because of that sin, many were made sinners, the Bible said. Many were made sinners. In fact, everyone was made a sinner. The only person that ever lived on the face of the earth that never sinned was the Lord Jesus Christ. But every man and woman that ever lived had that sin nature and still has that sin nature. Because of Adam's sin, we were all bound and doomed for a place called hell that God created for the devil and his angels, but it increases daily because of men's sins that go off into that everlasting burning lake of fire. Because of this sin, grace had to step up to take our place in the ring. I want to do something a little different today. As I look at this, I want to look at it as this mighty battle. And we all know, if you've ever watched any of the fights, you ladies may not have watched any fights, but probably your husband did, and you had to hear it from the kitchen or had to listen to it. But as the fight would take place, every time there's a fight, there's always an announcer. And the announcer's always over on the ringside, and he makes all the announcements. He has all of them listed out. As this great battle took place that day, I imagine that our announcer that morning over the loudspeaker, he comes up and he's, "Ladies and gentlemen, we're fighting a battle today. It's a battle of all ages. It's a battle that will affect every man, woman, and child on the face of the earth. Ladies and gentlemen, our first opponent that approaches in the ring today, in the corner, stands the man. He's been very good at his work. This man, he's large, he's mean, he's ugly today. This man has a lot of talent, and he defends his title tonight. This man's name is Sin." As Sin stands in his place on the ringside, confident, sure, boastful, proud, blaspheming, as he stands there with that look of hate in his eyes. He's honed his skills. He knows every move. He knows every knockout punch. He knows every little way to cheat. He knows everything to do to his opponent to beat him into submission. He's very good at it. He's been practicing it thousands of years. In fact, he began there in the portals of heaven as his trainer named Satan once was an angel named Lucifer. As this angel was the mighty cherub angel that resided there in heaven. Many say that he perhaps might have been the choir leader of heaven, a very beautiful angel. But he stands in the ringside this morning behind sin. Satan stands there. He spends his time looking for talent all over this world to be able to fight in this battle. He honed his skills very craftily. He walked to and fro upon the earth, perfecting his skills. And so he's very good at training people. He likes to begin when they're young. We read throughout the Bible many people that he trained throughout the ages. You may recall names such as Pharaoh, such as Nebuchadnezzar, such as Saul of Tarsus there for a time. You may remember a wicked woman named Jezebel. Oh, this man has been training people for years and years. And he's very good at it. He is the best in the business. You may remember a man named Judas that he once trained. He trained Judas very well. He stands there, and like I said, he likes to try to motivate them when they're young. We don't have many young people in here this morning, but young people, I want you to know that this man, this Satan, he likes to get you while you're young, while you're vulnerable, while you're not wise to some of the things in the world. He comes to you and he whispers in your ear, that shiny thing that you see in the store that you want, that your parents said no, that you can't have, go ahead and take it. Nobody will ever find out. The security cameras can't see you from that angle. Go ahead. You'll be happy if you'll take it. He does other things. He whispers in your ear, go ahead while you're taking a test. Look over at your friend's paper. It doesn't hurt anybody. Everybody else does it. Look over there and see their answers and write them down on yours. You want to make a good grade, don't you? Oh, he keeps it up. Yeah. Click on that internet site your friend told you about. You know, the one with all the awful, wicked pictures on it. Your parents will never find out. You're smarter than them. Your parents are stupid. They don't know how the internet works. They don't know about tracking cookies and all those things on the internet. You can clear all those out. They'll never find out. You want to see that stuff, go ahead and you can tell all your friends about it. Go ahead and say those bad words. Your parents won't find out. You can use that kind of language at school. All your friends do, and they're good people. It doesn't mean it makes you look kind of cool. It makes you look like an adult. Go ahead and say them. It doesn't matter what your dad says. Look at him. He's obviously doesn't know, have a clue. And Satan likes to get them while they're young. And he will use their teachers for his purpose to tell them, oh, your parents go to church? That's silly. You mean they believe in creation? That's ridiculous. We all know it's a big bang that created this world. We know you come from a monkey. And this trainer, Satan, he uses men and women to get your children to train them early. He's not just interested in the young talent. He wants the older, more seasoned talent as well. He especially likes to train those that call themselves Christians. Oh, this man, Satan, he's very good at it. He will enter into your thoughts at the most unsuspecting time. Even when everything's going good, when you think you're doing right, when you're living your best, he comes and he whispers in your ear and tries to convince you of things. Oh, go ahead. Put down that extra zero on your spending account at work, on your business report. Everybody does it. As long as you don't go over the per diem, they'll never find out. You don't have to hand any receipts if it's under $35. Go ahead and put it to the max. Everybody does it and they know it. Hey, go ahead and watch that movie filled with nudity. You're an adult. That doesn't affect you. You know it doesn't. I mean, you're not a child. Everybody's watching that kind of thing. Go ahead and watch it. Go ahead and watch that show about a demoniac and vampires and things on TV. Everybody in the world's doing it. It's the best watched movie in all the land. You're an adult. You can do this. Go ahead. Flirt with that guy or that girl in the office. Your husband or wife will never find out. They don't go to your office. They don't know. It's exciting. Go ahead and do it. Nobody will know. They'll never find out. Are you really going to go to church this morning? I mean, you've worked hard all week. I mean, you're busy. You need time for yourself. You deserve it. You don't need to go down there to that church today. Not today. Go next Sunday. Well, Brother Byron, he'll understand. They've been a lot of people out lately. Just lay in bed today. You need to. Get up later and go out to eat or something. Have a good day. It's Sunday. It's what everybody else is doing. Don't worry about it. Just go next time. Yeah, this sin, he stands tall in the corner with his trainer, Satan, right behind him. As his trainer has puffed him up and he's trained. And by the way, did I mention he is a natural-born killer in the ring? He doesn't just fight just to win. He fights to the death. In fact, the Bible says, wherefore, as by one man sin entered into the world, and death by sin. And so death passed upon all men, for that all have sinned. Yes, my friends, he's looking to fight to the death. Sin seems to be the obvious winner. As you watch a battle, a boxing match, a wrestling match, you always look at the opponents and you look to see who's the bigger. We see sin is that 1,000-pound elephant standing in the corner. He's the gorilla. He's huge. He's large. He's toned. His reach outreaches anyone else. He's the obvious winner in this battle. I mean, obviously. He's got the most knockouts on his record. He has already went and printed up the t-shirts and the hats for his championship title. So he's ready. He's obviously, put your money on him. If you're a betting person, put your money on sin. And then the announcer comes back on the loudspeaker. As our next opponent enters the ring, we hear the announcer, "Ladies and gentlemen, fighting in the opposite corner this morning of the ring, he's meek, he's lowly, he's humble, and he's full of love. Let's give it up, ladies and gentlemen, for Grace." As Grace kneels to one knee in the corner of the ring, with a look of love on his face. He's known by many names. In fact, his trainer is the most well-known name in all the world. The Great I Am is his trainer. He's also known as many other names, such as the stone that the builders rejected. He's also known as the Ancient of Days. He's known as the Great Shepherd, and he's also known as the Lamb that was slain. This man, Grace, as he stands in the corner, as he looks, he has a look on his face as well. But it's not a look of confidence or boasting or pride, but it's a look of love, a look of mercy, a look of longing, a look of pleading on his face as he stands to his feet in the ring. Grace stands there and he looks lovingly across the ring into the ugly black abyss in the eyes of sin as he peers at him across the ring. A hush falls over the audience as they stand and see these two opponents ready to battle in the center of the ring. Suddenly the announcer comes back onto the intercom. "Ladies and gentlemen, this battle is a battle to death. It's a fight between life and death this morning, and the winner will prevail." As the battle begins, the referee stands out in the middle of the two opponents. And the referee's there with a list of rules to follow. The referee comes out and he reads off the rules. "Moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound. The law did everything it could to make the match fair, so that neither side had an advantage, so that neither one would take advantage of the other. All the rules were laid out there, step by step, on what they must do to be able to fight fairly." But then suddenly, Grace speaks out. Grace says, "Think not that I'm come to destroy the law or the prophets. I'm not come to destroy, but to fulfill." And so the match begins. As the bell rings, Sin comes out swinging. He comes out swinging hard. He runs toward his opponent, beating and pummeling, pounding and breaking down and kicking and stomping and biting and screaming. He comes out with everything that he has. He holds nothing back. The rules have done went out the window. The referee cannot step in between them as the Sin comes through and starts beating his opponent. You can hear the angry cries from the crowd, "Crucify him! Crucify him! Kill him!" As Sin steps up and beats Grace, pounds Grace, tries to beat him in Bolivian. Why is Grace not fighting back? Grace is just standing there taking it. Grace never swung a punch. Grace never did anything. Grace didn't try to defend himself. He just took the beat. He just took it blow by blow by blow by pounding by pounding. Every time Sin pounded up on Grace, he took it and sat there and just took it in the middle of the ring. Sin beat him over and over and over. He was oppressed. and he was afflicted, yet he opened not his mouth. He's brought as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep before her shears is dumb, so he opened not his mouth. In the middle of all the uproar and all the cheering and all the screaming and the crowd, we hear Grace cry out, Eli, Eli, lama sabachthani, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? As he stands in the middle of the ring, being beat and pounded, a voice yells out in the crowd, somebody stop the fight. It's gone too far. It's obvious he's going to kill him. Stop it. Somebody give him some mercy. But we hear that it pleased the Lord to bruise him. He put him to grief. The fight's gone way too far now. It's no longer fun. The audience is aghast now. The audience can't believe their eyes. They're sickened to their stomachs. This beautiful man of grace that stood there in the ring with a look of love on his face is now, he's nothing to look at. He's nothing but ugly. He's not something anybody wants to see. They all turn their backs against him. He's no form nor comeliness. And when we shall see him, there's no beauty that we should desire him. He's despised and rejected of men, a man of sorrows, acquainted with grief, and we hid, as it were, our faces from him. He was despised, and we esteemed him not. Surely he's borne our griefs and carried our sorrows, yet we did esteem him stricken, smitten of God, and afflicted. He was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we're healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We've turned everyone to our own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. So everybody looked away. Everybody looked away from Grace. They couldn't stand to look upon him. And a hush fell over the crowd, and suddenly they heard Grace speak. And Grace said, Father, please forgive them. They don't know what they're doing. It's sin. And his trainer, oh, they're almost already ready to take the title. They're rejoicing. The referee steps in. He starts the countdown. 3, 2, 1. And Grace bowed down on his knees. And he bowed his head and he cried out, it is finished. Sin. And his trainer, Satan, they go to the center of the ring. They're ready to hold their hands up in victory. And suddenly the announcer comes back over the loudspeaker. Ladies and gentlemen, by unanimous decision this morning, the winner of tonight's heavyweight championship of the world is Grace! Sin looks across to the announcer. Sin looks over at Grace. Sin looks back at Satan. And he says, what's up? What does he mean he's the winner? I've been defeated. I've never lost before. And Grace stands up and says, you did this time. You've lost it forever. Oh, and he took the keys to the gates of hell and to the pit. And he threw him into the bottomless pit. Oh, and he won it forever and ever. As Grace became victorious that day, as the referee took his hand and he held it up high. And he said, you're the winner. You're the undisputed winner of the world. You're the heavyweight championship of the world. And Grace has won over sin. He's defeated death, hell, and the grave this morning. Friends, I want you to know that the audience erupted in laughter as all the host of heaven was joyous and singing and praises. And it said, wherefore God has highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. As Satan cowered off into this corner and tried to leave the arena that morning, and he was vowing revenge and cursing his name, but Grace was victorious that day. Grace took on sin, Grace took on Satan, and Grace won the battle, and Grace always will. I've read the back of the book, and Grace has won. And my friend, this morning, as we read from our scripture today, Grace is a free gift given to you. And it's up to you to take that gift of grace. If you didn't take that gift of grace, you're bound for the devil's hell. You're bound to go there where sin and Satan will reside for all of eternity in a burning lake of fire. My friend, grace is victorious, and you must accept Jesus as your Savior. The Bible says, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish but have everlasting life. He meant that for you. Now I want to tell you something this morning. You may not have seen it within our scripture. You may not have heard it in the message this morning, but I want you to know the reason that battle took place that day, the reason that battle was performed there in that arena that day, was because of you, and it was because of me. It was because of our sin that we commit against Him willingly, and because of our sin, we were bound for a devil's hell, but grace took our place. Grace took your place in that ring that day. Grace stood in for you that day so that you didn't have to fight that battle, so that you weren't defeated, so that you didn't have to go to hell that day. Oh, but my friend, have you trusted in Jesus as your Savior? Have you accepted that free gift of grace that He gave you? Oh, He looks out upon this crowd this morning, and He knows your heart, He knows your mind, He knows your soul, He knows everything about you. And my friend, if you've not trusted Him as your Savior today, you will die from here. You will go to a devil's hell, and you will be there forever. Oh, it's too important to wait for another day. If you've never trusted Him as your Savior, may this be the day that you come down to this altar this morning and let me show you from the Bible what it means to truly be saved today. Oh, don't trust in your own self. Don't trust in somebody else's salvation. Don't trust in some little promise you made to somebody. Don't trust in your granny or your papa's salvation, because it won't save you. You must be born again, and you must trust Jesus as your personal Savior to be saved today. I want to ask Matthew, he's going to play a song this morning, and this song, I want you to listen to the words of it, and I want you to be very attentive of it. And this morning, if you need help today for anything, I'm going to ask you to come to this altar and meet me down here. I'll show you in the Bible what the Bible says on how you must be saved today. Would you come down if you need help? Let's stand this morning and you listen to this song.